approach to it. So we describe everything from the boats up to the consumers. That provides some information which is passed on through this management procedure to the people in the black room we saw before. They set the policies. And they do that based on the information they get from the management procedures here, from the indicators and status that Anna talked about. And we've added one more thing to it here, because they don't just get those, but they also get a picture of what's in the ecosystem. They get the experience that the fishermen have, by what's in this system. We provide that to visualizations of the ecosystems. And let's have a look. In order to do that, we had to come up with quite an array of tools. And this here is actually the rest of my talk. I'll be talking about how we redevelop EWE, how we got the hydrographic models to talk to the climate models, to talk to the ecosystem models and so on. The value chain, I've used already. We need to talk about protected areas and spatial optimizations is an important aspect of that. We are developing this as a decision support methodology, and that's a whole field of science in itself. And we use the last two forms, the visualizations and thinking about how we communicate as part of that. So this is the package that what's in it. The main thing that's happened with this new model here is that we have modularized it. We've broken it down in components, even to the degree that if you don't like the way that we handle functional response or something else, you can very easily replace it. It has really become very, very modular, and as such, we can widen the group involved in it considerably, and we are working very actively on this. And importantly, we have separated the interface from the actual software. That's a technical detail, but that's what makes it possible to link to other models and to use different ways of communicating the science. I'm actually going to skip pretty quickly over this one here, because we have developed these methods for how we couple the models, how we get the models to talk together. We've done it in various ways. We can do it, including we can do it over the internet. And we are actually doing that. For instance, we are right now, that's the next slide, developing coupling between Atlantis and Eberspace, and that's with Beth sitting in Hobart and us sitting in Vancouver, and our machines are just talking together for each time step as they run along and send information back and forth. That's beautiful, and this is an area, you see there's lots of cases of this now. This is actually an area where there's some really interesting science going on. It's a question of we all best the models that we are developing. Now, we're good at this, you're good at that. Let's get our models to talk together. So for each time that we exchange information. This is going to be something that will really change the way we look at science in the coming years. That's a whole list of activities related to this. This by itself is a beautiful field. Now, value chain modeling. The top part there, that's what's often called the end-to-end modeling. We are adding to it. What happens with processing, distributing, selling, consumer? We are adding a web to the food web here, an economical web on top of the food web. So if you look at, well, what if we have changed in the environment? We can use that to predict what's going to be happening for the supply to the consumer. For DFO, you call this now from seed to plate. This is well integrated here, and at the moment, I think I know about 10 case studies that are actually applying it. It's not vaporware. So this is another area where we're going to see a lot of interest and discussion. It's good ecological modeling being linked to good economical modeling. That's what it boils down to, and it can only be done by having professionals of both sides working together. This is neat. Important aspect of that, very detailed revenue and cost accounting, but also we have an explicit way of taking care of the things we don't like talking about, like aquaculture and catch release fisheries and whale watching and dive boats. What's the potential for that? What's the potential for revenue? It's being handled explicitly in quite a neat way. Spatial conservation, we work with Native Conservancy there to develop a tool where we can add conservation layers, as we do in Markson. Very similar to what's done with Markson, put that into a framework, and that's enough about that, because I want to get to the fun part, communicating the science. This is what we're good at, right? Spreadsheets, graph, and you all get it. You see, there are some serious problems somewhere in this. How do you communicate this? is this the best science? This is the way to do it? Well, we are working now on thinking about what we do with visualization. We want to visualize how the system has changed in historic time. We want to show what is the current state of the system and how the system reacts to human impact and to climate change. There's a lot of science aspects involved in this, like how do you visualize numbers? How do you get human and computers to work together in the best possible way? That's a field of computer science, and we're working very close to those people. How do you develop a cooperative environment? What kind of challenges we have put forth for our black room meetings? Now, for visualization's part of it, Finding Nemo is very popular in these circles here because of Nemo. It's a number of you will know about. But Finding Nemo, that's a rented game, you know. You produce image by image, and you can make beautiful things that way. Now, we do that using a 3D gaming engine, an open source gaming engine. It's open source, just like EWE is open source and free and no money involved. So we're using such a 3D gaming engine. History Center has actually become the hub for this gaming engine in Vancouver. We host a number of workshops. We do that to scout and find the good people to work for us. Lots of amateurs in this. So we use this rendering to make documentaries showing things that National Geographic can't show. For instance, we made a 6-minute video with Noah about Chesapeake Bay, how it has developed in historic times, and how it may look in the future. I'd be happy to show that, but not in half an hour. It's a 6-minute one, but I think I'll be running out of time before then. And right now we're talking to Henrik, who's here, about making a similar one about the Baltic Sea. And I can see a number of these documentaries, all animated, just describing what we know about the science and how systems have changed. They're pretty neat. So that's one aspect, that's the visualizations, that's the renderings. The other is a gaming aspect. And this is, the main difference there is, it's not picture by picture that's canned and that you just play in video afterwards. It's real-time rendering. And given that we are in Bill Gates' home city, I'm going to be as brave as he is. I'm going to actually run visualization live here on my non-PC. Unfortunately, I have to do it with Windows, and so I'm not quite sure whether it actually works. We have connected EchoSim to this Blender, the 3D gaming engine. And as far as we know, no one has ever used a gaming engine this way before, letting it communicate science real time. You have it, but it mainly has been done as renderings of the other kind, you know, where you do it static. But actually doing it real time so that you can come in and say, could you show me what would happen if we change effort, if we impact the subsidies, if we, you know, that kind of questions that we posed. What would the ecosystem look like and what would the indicators look like? That's what we've done with this. We connected the scientific engine to the gaming engine. And we're currently using this for two games. One is a single player fishing game. I might show you if I'm not out of time, I might be, but it's a simple game for communication where you have absolute rights to fishing in an area which is not very heavily exploited. You can buy boats, more boats, and when you bought enough, okay, you'll be over exploiting the resource and you're going to find you get some green fees for that. And your objective is very simple, make money. That's what you're there for. Without crashing the ecosystem, because if you crash the ecosystem, you won't make money. So we're looking at that, and it's a nice little game for the child and all of us. But it's one that educates about this illogical science that we are dealing with. More effort doesn't mean more fish. The other one is the important one for the management meetings I was talking about. We call them Ocean Summits. A multiplayer decision support game. Game is in quotation marks somewhere here. This is the foundation for the Ocean Summits. And it has two-way communication. Here's a simple diagram of it. If you don't think it's simple, you should see the real thing, the way, not what you see, you'll see the real thing in how it looks in vision, but how we've done that. Because we're talking about something, we have EchoSim running in the background, an EchoSpace as well. That's in .NET. It has to communicate to a gaming engine which talks Python. And we have to sit there and control it and send information back and forth. I can tell you one thing, that is, I got some really capable programmers, professional people working on this, and they hate me for just asking them to do this. It took this techno a while to do it, but it's actually working. So that's what we're doing in this room here, and I'm pretty certain that this is an indication that I should pull out the plug and I can assure you, this is just a cheap bit because I forgot that a little thing here. That's the single player game you see up there. And you know those damn maps, they need this one as well. Any resemblance to living or dead people is purely coincidental. We go here. Do we need to do anything else to get this over here? It should come. We tried last night, I should say. I want to show this live. If I can't get it working live, I'll have to show you a video of it. But that's not so fun. Shoot. It might be the control here. Yes, that's the same as last night. Now what happened to it? Just like
it
moved out.
Windows.
It went to the other window, you think? There we are. Haha. Bill Gates did it. There we go. You can see part of my screen now. That's a very good sign. So here we are in Visual Studio 2008, and I'm going to be running this. And that should hopefully give us a black screen. Yep, it is. Press 2 to start Blender with 3D visualizations. Oh, we do that. See what happens. Now, nothing. Still a black screen. Well, it takes a little while. So this here is an interface to Ecosim. 5 minutes, thank you. That'll be enough. You can crash this ecosystem and the computer before then. This is an interface of Ecosim. Ecosim dictates what show up here, what species. We've got about 100 photorealistic species rendered so far. What shows up at what point in time? Now, a point in time is I press G. Now I go in and I load a .NET interface. You can see up there you have the year. And when I don't run Ecosim in the background, which I can show you next, this here just shows a linear decrease. So this here is the good old days, like 2005. And you can see how much fish there was in the ocean back then, in those old days. How do we communicate these numbers? That's a challenge we have right now with this. How do we communicate change in populations, in what species composition there is from 2005, and then we go out and we look into the future where everything is green and so on. This is just a linear decline, just to illustrate it. A very different kind of systems. We're doing this with Ecosim, so the numbers are actually representing what we know about the history, how things have changed. We need to scale things up and down, but the relative numbers is best available science. So we can do that this way. And we want to, in a way, remove the scientist from the equation here. Behind this is very complex models. But the interface that we're using for this doesn't have to be complicated. Now I'm just going to run over here in Ecosim because I need to run a simulation from here. This is out from the control room in the background. I'm doing visualization. I'll just show you here how we map all the species to Blender mesh names. So it knows what's going on there. But now we are running a simulation. And I can press a button here and cross my fingers that this doesn't always work, but it might work if I click a button here. We get a simple interface here, which is just nonsense here, but this makes it possible to change effort, as an example. We can also go in and we can look at various kinds of indicators. And actually, we would just love to, for instance, do some of the things you showed us, Anne. That would be really neat to get those in. We could, for instance, look at biomasses, this form, cumulative plot, whatever kind of indicators come there. And this is what we want to take out to the decision makers then, or into this public group that is talking about the fisheries in this place. So that's how we're setting it up. And catches, how about catches? They look, again, this is a play case that we're doing right now, but the communication is actually there. This works, talks to the model talks back again. That's pretty cool to get that working, I can tell you. Let's see if I can get rid of that screen there again, and we can go back to good old days. Somehow I can't get rid of that. Maybe I'm pressing it anymore. This is groups. There we go. I'm basically done. This is what we're playing with now. Comes in from what we, the screens we put on top there. That's where you have to communicate this. I have no idea about how big this child here is going to go to, what kind of child it's going to go into. That's the nice thing about working with research. But I still think it has a very strong message to send. We heard Jake talk about the cotton on the East Coast. Now, can you imagine how it looked before? You can imagine your mind, the sea full of cod, and now we have one with some polar cods and some shrimp and some crabs. Just being able to visualize that, I think that is can have a powerful impact on itself. And I really do believe that we can do a lot of bug management without Andre, that without his complicated models, that we might, that's a very simple method. You are the scapegoat, of course you have to be one like that. So this is going to complement. That's all I can say. How far it's going to take depends a lot on how we've been working with you, because we have developed this methodology here, but the actual meetings where it's going to be used is something that has to be done in close cooperation with you guys, or wherever it may be. So, that's a long answer, same way, but that's good for the scientists.
Thanks, Billy.
Yeah.
And, and we'll have the panel discussion later where we can follow up on other questions if you have them. And also, I want to point out that if you're in need of a seat, there's still some up kind of in the middle here. You could just make everybody else move. And this is our last talk before lunch break, and then we'll continue after lunch with another talk and the panel discussion. So. Next is Lisa Vonick from the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary Program, who will be talking about MPAs and ecosystem-based fisheries management.
Thank you for the invite today to the symposium organizers, particularly Andre. I think I have him to thank for being here. It's such an honor to be here and to see a lot of the speakers and people present here today that have informed my talk today, my presentation. And as Phil said, the topic is MPAs as a tool for ecosystem-based fishery management, and I'll touch on upon some issues of scale, perspective, and coordination. So I also took PowerPoint 101. We'll be covering a couple of definitions. I'll cover a national overview of MPAs. MPAs is a tool for EBFM. And then going down in scale and focusing on a West Coast overview of MPAs. And then I'll finish it up with strategies for better integration and using a promising example, the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary's MPA planning process, to better integrate MPAs with EBFM through better coordination with our partners. So you'll be hearing many definitions today of EBFM. The one that I liked was the one by Marasco et al., in which recognizes that there are many definitions with recurring themes. EBFM is interdisciplinary, it's holistic, it's specified geographically. That's what it has in common with MPAs, because they're also specified geographically. Space matters. It considers interactions in the system, trophic interactions, interactions of users, not just fishermen or fisheries. Looks at biophysical interactions. It really advances the concept beyond single species management. Humans are an explicit part of the system, and it looks at the full range of ecosystem goods and services, and because it does that, it evaluates competing interests, and decisions need to be made concerning those competing interests. And so a quick definition is that EBFM recognizes the physical, biological, economic,